Well, good morning, Blue Troopers. And I only have the one day off, so I'm not going to be doing a live stream today. Going to be a busy, busy boy. But I did want to get a video knocked out real quick. Now, I have hinted at something World War I-y, and also, is that a word, World War I-y? You know, World War I oriented. And I've also talked about some art and stuff and a few things that are coming, but I said I didn't want to talk about it until I got here. Well, I got here. Now, you guys know the SE5 composite that I have. Well, I was able to acquire some more from the estate of the late Craig Cadera, and I have plans for all of it, primarily just to protect it and take good care of it. I'll be showing you some pictures of it. And most of them are World War I aircraft. There's also the Revell B-57 and also the LaCrosse rocket truck from Revell, which, by the way, I actually happen to have a repop of, and that artwork. Now, most of them were done by Jack Linwood, although I do know that the truck was done by Richard Cashotti. So I'm going to show some pictures at the end of all this, and then it'll be a while before I get around to doing things, but now you understand why I was looking for more SC5s and also some Fokker D7s from the old 172nd Revell stuff. I want to try and find the original boxes. Now, you guys may have heard me mention this, but that white Fokker D7 behind the SC5 on the SC5 box is supposed to be, or I'm pretty sure supposed to be, the same white Fokker D7 that's the cover of the Fokker D7 box, and for those who don't know, that's Hermann Göring's airplane. And that would make sense being part of, sort of the uniform Jack Linwood universe. Now, for those who don't know, these comps are, what would happen is, as I understand it was explained to me, is that the artists would have a chat with the art director from a company like Revell or Monogram, give them an idea what they want, they draw some sketches, they go, this is what we had in mind, and then they would paint these composites out of gouache, which is a watercolor, and then it would say, okay, maybe a few more changes. For example, if you notice the SE5 comp, there's a red disc in the wheel, which is not in the final box art. Maybe they didn't like it, maybe they just thought it looked better without it, whatever. That's what the art director wanted. And then after the comp was approved, the artist would do the full size painting, and that sort of course would be photographed and become the box art. And breaks my heart is, apparently a lot of these things just ended up in the trash afterwards. Oh, I can feel the dagger slipping into my back when I say that. But it is what it is. Now, on the other news, or things going on, a lot of times your model building skills come in handy for things you never expected. For example, this is my CPAP mask. I'm sure plenty of you guys have noticed in morning videos of the straps. The strap marks on my face. Well, this is for my travel mask. I have a small one for traveling, a CPAP unit. And the rubber didn't break, it just unpeeled, unstuck. And I slid it back on, but it won't stay in place. So I'm gonna take it in the Tarvis and probably use some of that Loctite that was sent to me. That would probably be the best thing to use, I would think, because this stuff looks like it's gonna be hard to bond to. But I don't think regular model cement would do it, but I'm gonna try and fix this. If not, I gotta go spend a whole bunch of money on a new one. And I know what you're all thinking, how expensive can it be? It's a medical component, please. I'll bet you that's a few $100 to replace, probably. The other thing was, talking about the Red Caboose in Midtown Manhattan, New York, I forgot to mention on my video that I did buy the Vanguard model. There was so much other stuff I wanted to get there because, as a lot of you guys pointed out, I definitely spent my whole allowance there. But remember, I had to fit it in my bag and get it back home. And I still had it's a good way for that stuff to get crushed. And I didn't show the back of the box, which has the various Vanguard paint schemes. Glencoe really made a nice box. Now, this box is a wrap. It's a box with the paper with the glue-on paper wrap on it. And I didn't realize this the earlier Glencoe kits, but you have to slit the paper down the edges for the box to open. And I did take some pictures of the parts and the box. You have the parts of the stand and the gantry and everything. And The instructions are pretty good. It's got a nice history in there of the rocket. And I tell you what, I really think that I haven't built the kit yet. This I've always wanted this. I want to put on my rocket display so as quick as I can. But the fact that it's got the little gantry and everything with it, I think that really makes a huge difference. That's one of the reasons I wanted to get it. Plus, you guys know I'm a space fan. And Lenko even used the same box art that was on the original Adams kit. And Adams made some really good molds. I've only built one Adams kit, but I was really impressed with it, and I'd heard good things about them. And, you know, they started making stuff for Revell, and then they went off on their own, and Adams and his sons. And unfortunately, Nick Argento over at Lenko had mentioned that it sometimes people can get a little silly about what they think the molds are worth, and that can hold up them going back into production again. But I'm really looking forward to it. The Vanguard was essentially a modified Araby High with an extra stage, and it was an early attempt to get a satellite up during the space race. And it was just basically to cobble something together. They only had about 3 successful launches, about 10 tries. In fact, they gave this beautiful little summary of it. It gets right down to the engine type and stuff. The Vanguard rocket was designed as a 3-stage vehicle. The first stage was a General Electric X405 liquid-fueled engine derived from the engine of the RTV N12A Viking. And Viking was another rocket. And the second stage was an Aerojet AJ-10-37 liquid-fueled engine, a variant of the engine on the RTV-N-10 Araby. So like I said, it was kind of a modified, well, saying it was a modified Araby is underselling it. But anyway, finally the third stage was a solid propellant rocket motor. Vanguard had no fins, and the first stages were steered by gimbaled engines. Mind you, this is 1957. The second stage also housed the vehicle's telemetry system, the inertial guidance system, and the autopilot. The third stage was spin stabilized and was initiated by a turntable on the second stage before separation. T10, they were TVs. TV0 and TV1 were successful test firings in December 56. So they were actually doing this in 56. And in May of 57, but in October of that year, the Soviets had put Sputnik into orbit. As a result, a rushed third Vanguard TV2 with the Vanguard satellite was launched in December 6, 1957. But within moments of launch, it exploded on the pad. We've probably all seen that footage of it exploding, the nose cone falling off. In February 5th, TV-3BU, BU standing for backup, failed in flight. March 17th of 58, TV-4 finally launched a successful satellite into orbit. By this time, the Army had successfully launched the Explorer 1 satellite on a Jupiter C rocket as America's first artificial satellite. And a little asterisk down there, you can also build a model of the first satellite Explorer 1 by Glenco Models, which is what I have up on the shelf. A total of 11 Vanguards produced, only 3 would successfully launch satellites into orbit. I think these histories are great. They're as much fun as the model. That's how I learned a lot of my stuff about these things. Well, guys, like I said, I got a lot going on today, so I'm going to have to get to it. I have a family function tonight, so a friend of ours is moving away, so I don't think there's going to be any evening content. I'm not going to have a chance to build today. But I want to thank everybody for watching. I'm now going to show you pictures of the pictures. And I don't have them here with me because I have my morning coffee on the table for real. And the cat is sitting over there knowing full well that she owns the place. And I don't want to risk anything happening to the pictures there in a safe location. And I don't want them anywhere near any liquids or any animals that might decide, that gouache tastes good, lick, 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 or sit on them or anything else. And I had to have my morning coffee. Guys, thanks for tuning in. Oh, by the way, I'm not going to show you a picture, so don't worry, because it would be a horrible graphic image, but I'm limping along today because after that 1.5-mile trek back and forth to the hobby shop, to the Red Caboose, which I absolutely you guys are right. I'm so glad I did that. I wish I could have gotten there earlier and had more time to yak with Alex. Great guy. He's one of us. But I got a blister about that big under my right foot, so I'm limping along here for a little while, but anyway, guys, once again, thanks for viewing. Take care and model on.